basically, when Java 8 was being introduced, there were everyone was happy. Yeah, it was supposed to be like functional ideas brought to Java in a perfect way, but obviously it wasn't. At the beginning, everyone was pretty happy, but after time went by, people started noticing that something is not really right. And actually, when it comes to the functionness of Java 8, you could see that those were basically, well, lambda expressions introduced in like a very nice and tidy way. Optional stream compatible feature, those monadic containers, and not really much more. And sometimes some people thought that basically all those functional programming in Java is pretty much like this, which is far from being what really functional programming is. So what happened? People starting noticing that stuff like, oh well, there are only three functional control structures, three monadic containers, and languages like Scala, they have much more. They have try, validation, either, lazy, and other stuff like this. Why not add them here? No, I don't know. The concept of memoization is not utilized. Memoization means caching results after calculating them and in the future just retrieving them from a cache. So for example, if you memoize a function, if we call it with one particular input, it will, if we call it again, it will get cached, and if we call it again, it will return straight from a cache. There is no function lifting. Function lifting is a process of changing partial functions. Functions might throw exceptions into a total functions, which always returns some result for every given input. There is no concept of pattern matching introduced to Java. Pattern matching is like a very switch case on steroids. Still no tuples, Java 8, and still we don't have enough way of using tuples. We still need to use very simple GitHub projects, Apache Commons or something else if we want to connect to objects together. Well, optional for some reason doesn't implement serializable or iterable. I've been to DevOps, and Stuart Marx has some very good explanation for why it's not implementing serializable. Well, the explanation in like simply put is like it wasn't intended to work like this, but well, it's a good explanation, but it doesn't really convince me. We got stream and optionals, but many APIs still did not, well, in Java, they are on this holy quest for preserving the backwards compatibility. So obviously, if we already had some methods in APIs that would return nullable, for example, nullable references, of course, can't be changed. They need to stay like this. We can add more on top of it. But at the end of the day, it only creates a confusion because you have some method just return nulls, some returns optionals, and it gets very, very confusing. But obviously nothing we can do because Java is ensuring backwards compatibility. Another problem was checked exceptions used in functions. As already mentioned by someone here, the problem is that functional interfaces, those methods in functional interfaces, at least by those provided by JDK, they don't have a throws clause in the method signature. So whenever you encounter a checked exception, you need to pretty much any time just kind of swipe it under the carpet or just repack it into a runtime exception that doesn't cause compilation errors. Another thing is type pollution. Is what we could observe at the beginning of the first session is that we had shitloads of different functional interfaces, different names. There is function by function, there is predicate by predicate, consumer by consumer, unary operator, binary operator, and so on and so on. There are quite a lot of them. So, and it gets really confusing which one to use, because suddenly In the API, you see by consumer, and you need to think, you need to be aware of what it actually is. Well, it could have been much simplified when by using just simply one function or just use slightly different naming convention. By the way, also all functional interfaces in Java 8 go up to arity of 2. So if you want a function that accepts 3 or 4 parameters, unfortunately in this case you need to create your own interface, so which is absurd. Some operations are still, well, we managed to remove some kind a little bit of boilerplate, but still in such situations like here, you can see that probably, well, this stream call here and collect to list is not really that necessary. Well, we could, if we wanted to just filter or map values in a list, we could simply just do it without explicitly recollecting it into another list. Well, probably there are many more other problems like this, but let's focus only on the most important ones. Well, so today I'd like to talk to you about JavaSlang. JavaSlang was a project. Let's see, the page is javaslang.io. It's a project that brings as much as possible functional goodies to Java. So what's here is the whole new collections API. Those collections are persistent and fully immutable. You have much more functional control structures because except for getting optional streams, you get lazy, validation, either, try, and few more. You have implemented, but there is a pattern matching implemented, let's say. Well, it works, but of course we are limited by, it's not a language level construct, so it's still pretty limited, but still can make some stuff much easier for us. And another thing is a set of tuples and a set of new functional interfaces. Everything is of course mutable and pretty much on steroids. The APIs are very rich, and well, if you couldn't do anything in Stream API, obviously you can do this with JavaSlang. If you can't, just drop an issue on GitHub and guys either will accept it and implement it quickly or just tell you politely why it's not the case without telling you to go to elementary school and learn functional basic algebra. Can you repeat, please?
What Java tall machine version is supported for this?
You need at least JDK 8 for this, of course. Unfortunately, you can't use this with previously because it utilizes functional interfaces and other classes that are present in the newest JDK release. Okay, so let's start. So the problem with Java 8 and functional interfaces was, I said before that we had so many different different names. So if you wanted to have a function, you could have function by function and so on and so on. Well, let's actually try. Imagine there were function interfaces in JDK 8 going up to arity of 8. Okay, so there will be function, by function, try function, quad function, queen function, and how does it go further? 6, 7, I don't know, right? Okay, it stops. So it would be really not really very easy to come up with this. So the first thing that was used in JavaSlang is totally abandon this convention from Java and use different naming. So what's happening over there is now we have very simple convention. If we want functions, it's function 0, obviously, nothing is there. We can have function 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, as you can see, pretty straightforward. So I bet that it's much easier to count from 0 to 8 than to actually name those arities.
This is the extent.
So as you can see, function one in this case is a function that takes only one argument and returns something else. And so on, and so on. So it, as you can see, it gets much more easier. It's not the only good thing about it. All of them come with like a brother function, which is called checked function. Of course, they all follow the same convention, so everything is very predictable. The difference with this one, well, checked function. Let's see. One
question. Why 8? This magic number.
Well, I don't really know how did they pick the magic number. The good thing about this is that all those sources are actually auto-generated. There are special Scala generators for this, so there's one like property that controls it. So if you want more, you can pretty much quickly like rebuild the whole project with like 200 or whatever you need. Yes, Java Slang uses Scala internally, at least for generating a lot of functions. Because let's be honest, us writing all of this manually would be pretty painful. So there are generators for this that deal with it. Okay, so let's create this one as D1. And what's the main difference over there? Well, let's leave this one. The problem here. In Java, actually, it's pretty much this one works exactly like the one in Java. Is that when you had, let's say, encountered a checked exception, new, what's the name of a throw new, any checked exception?
IO exception.
What? IO exception. Okay, and the problem here is that suddenly you can't do anything because it's unhandled. And, well, the first thing that comes to your mind to put like the throws here, but as you can see, it's already here, doesn't help anything. Why is this? Because, apply. Maybe this. Well, that pretty much here you don't have this throws clause, so it forces you pretty much to do this, and it looks really painful, especially when you have like a very long stream sequence and you have few maps, map calls over there, and let's say that you care only if any of them throws anything, because it basically disrupts the whole stream. But you can do this. You need to wrap each exception in like throw catch, and probably just repackage in runtime or just log it. It's really painful. Well, so let's leave it like this. The simple, very simple solution for this would be to create a set of other interfaces, checked interfaces, and those. It comes from here. No, it doesn't come from here. Apply. Yes, here. As you can see here, now there's this thing over there which allows us to create same kind of functions, but well, we need to return something here, string. So we can create exactly the same one. But this time, if we remove this, everything will be fine because the exception is in the method signature, the target method that this will be converted to as a lambda expression. So as you can see, we can use this in many, many different cases. So this is the first benefit from it. from the whole, this is the, basically the whole overview of the of new functional interfaces in JavaSlang. But what's super interesting is that if you go over there, and let's say create function one string as the say I plus one, you get a lot of nice goodies over here. So when we had a look at functional interfaces in Java, there were only basically basic additional methods for function composition over there. But here we have something like reversed, tupled, memorized, carried, RET, and then, well, as you can see, there, the API is much richer and much more interesting. Well, let's see it in action, okay? So for the first example, let's maybe use a different kind of function. Let's use function 2. Integer. It's sum, and it takes obviously two integers and sums them together. Okay, so let's have a look at carried. Carrying is the way of representing representation of functions of higher arities as function of arity of one. Arity means the number of initial arguments. So here we have function that has arity of two. It accepts two arguments, and if we try to carry it and change it to a function that has arity of one, we can do this very quickly by applying this. And let's see what we get when we do this. So after applying this, we got a totally new type. We got a function one that also accepts one integer, but instead of returning resulting value, it returns another function, okay? So if you actually wanted to call the first function and apply a sum, you would do just sum, apply, and just provide two of those here, and this is our result. But if you want to call carried in a carry representation, what you would do in such case is create so use carried, apply, but this returns again another function. So you would apply it again, and this would give you the carried result. And that's what you give the desired result. So as you can see, JavaSlang provides you also a very nice way of representing this in a carried way. What does it give us is a very easy way of applying partial application. So if you suddenly convert your function into a carried one, well, you don't need to apply all arguments at once. But actually, why not apply them one by one? I mean, only one at the same time. So if we apply only one, it will return us another function. But this function won't be a summing function that sums two, but two integers. But it will be a function that basically adds a two to our result, OK? By applying carrying and partial application, we managed to convert the already existing function that we have over there into something that adds only a two to our result, okay? So we managed to fix forever one of those initial parameters.
When you apply carrying to function of two arguments and transform it to function of one argument, what does it do internally? It just throws away one argument, and which one does it throw away?
Well, it doesn't really throw away. It just wraps it around in a. Well, we can just have a look. Why not?
Does it evaluate lazily?
Can you repeat, please?
Does it evaluate lazily?
Yes, it's all lazy. As you can see, it's nothing really special here because it's being done just converted from one function that returns another function. Well, it's maybe hard to see this because this is one first function that returns another one. Okay, and as you can see, you can do this even with actually, let's have a look at function 8. Can we go here? It has a carried method over there, and as you can see, it's all done manually and absolutely lazy because those are just function definitions. Their function is not really getting called at any of those moments.
Default values.
What?
Default values. Default values. If you want or some argument, you want default values.
I'm not sure if I understand correctly, but when you apply partial application in this case, the arguments get applied from the left side. So it's not, unfortunately, you can't pick any of the arguments that are inside. You need to just go from the left to right. Well, honestly, I think I've used this in practice a few times, but only in like very, very simple context, okay? Because honestly, for the last 2 years, maybe I used once or twice functions that were of higher arities than two. It's not something that you do very often. But I'd like to show you that this possibility exists and it's implemented in a very nice way. Okay, let's see another one. So we have this...
When it is useful to apply this current function?
Well, if you start writing your code in more functional way, you naturally start to abstract some things into functions, okay? And sometimes, in order to not reinvent the wheel, and not repeating the same constructs in code, you might just want to reuse already existing function by fixing one of the parameters. This is mostly the most practical option that I've used it with. Okay.
Can you in Java Swan create a function of arbitrary arity, like arity of 30 or 20?
No. Predefined are up to 8. Arity of 8 is max. Okay. So unfortunately, this is not possible. But if you really want, I think I mentioned that before, there is somewhere a magic property that's used when building a project. You could rebuild the Java Slang with the parameter like whatever you want and it would create everything. I'm not sure, well, of course, there is some physical limitation because I don't know how many arguments max can a method have. There is some physical limitation for this. No, I think it's not int max. There is a little bit lower because it's reserved for something else. Anyway, okay, because this is a very, very trivial. Those examples are very trivial, and we have much more interesting stuff to cover. So let's kind of switch this one. Let's switch the implementation again to something summing. Okay, we did something very bad again, which means placing side effects in a function over there. So let's start to call it actually. So let's try to sum, apply, you have two integers, 2 and 3. We don't really care about the result at this point, so summing. Okay. Something is summing. Okay, but let's say that we know that most of our function calls will statistically be used on the same parameters all over again. So in such case, maybe let's break it even more. Let's say that let's put a thread sleep that's not here. Let's put a very long one. Well, if it takes a substantial amount of time to calculate this, it would be really painful to recalculate this over and over again. And in such case, it would make quite a lot of sense to just cache the results. And this can be actually achieved in a very, very easy way in Java Slang, because all functions come with this method here, memorize, that allow you to enable simple caching for your functions. So if you do this, nothing changes because the signature is still the same. As you can see, the same type, but it's memorized sum. So let's try perform summing again. Apply to 2 and 3. What will happen right now? We should see the summing that's performed once over there. And as you can see, it's still there. Should this memorize some? But it, in this case, doesn't change anything. But what happened right now is that memorize sum at this point cached those results. So if we now copy it a few times over here, it's still only one sum. Okay? So I guess this is a very common question. Well, unfortunately, there is not much available at this point in JavaScript 2 when it comes to cache control. So you need to use it very responsibly. Okay, but probably as any other like data structures. Internally, I think it's using concurrent hash map for this. And what I wanted to say is. I forgot.
If you change the parameters,
of course, they will be cached again and put into a map. But obviously, the one very important point to remember in functional programming is that we expect functions to be pure, which means that whenever we are calling this function with set of arguments, it should always return exactly the same value. Okay, no side effects performed. This is why this is very bad, but it's good for like example purposes.
But if you swap arguments, like first one will be 3, second 2.
Oh yeah, I guess it shouldn't work. Okay, because it's not a word that this operation is commutative. So if we swap it, of course it shouldn't work. Well, I'm not 100% sure, but I would be really surprised if it worked. So something. Oh well, sorry. So this should give us 2 summing calls. Yeah. Yeah, it's not aware of the relationship between those 2 arguments. Yes?
So how do you determine that this is an equals? It's just a reference equals?
I guess. Well, I don't really know how it's done internally. Well, we can simply have a look at this, but...
So, if we'll pass in some an object, it should be immutable, right? So mm-hmm. Because if you mutate some object, it will
care. Yes, well, this is the other thing that the whole idea of functional programming is operating on immutable values. This is why it's all this, and pure functions. This is why it's possible at this point to just cache results. And don't worry if actually the result might change from those, because it shouldn't. Well, it's something that's really bad if it does, OK?
So if for some reason we receive box at integers, memorization will not work.
Well, I assume it compares not references but compares the actual equals value. Okay. Well, we can try simply. Let's say do this new integer of 3. Well, and this should result only in 2 summing calls. First one here, second here, and this should be. Yeah. So this is not a reference comparison.
Could you please try to put the number like 150, because integer has reserved memory for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good idea. Well, if this doesn't work, I would consider this a bug. Yeah. So everything fine. It's not a reference comparison, but value. So everything is fine. Okay, so let's go to another one. Oh, let's just copy this one. But basically we finished everything at this point with functions. So this is done. We can go further to another one, to tuple test. By the way, if you want to see, of course, obviously everything is on GitHub already. The first part of the workshop is on GitHub already, so just remember this address. Okay, let's go to tuples right now. In case you don't know, tuple is a construct that allows you to group few. It's like a concept of anonymous object. It allows you to group few references together. Usually in cases where the particular situation doesn't really deserve to be given a new class for the particular situation. So let's have a look at this. This is how it looks like. It comes from javaslang.tuple. And if you want to create one, you need to use the of method. And as you can see again, everything follows the same convention. And if you put one element here, you'll get tuple one. But if you put two elements here, you will get tuple two. So as you can see, everything in JavaScript is pretty straightforward and predictable.
Is it serializable?
Can you repeat?
Is it serializable?
Yes, everything is serializable. And what's more, it even implements iterable, and we'll get to this, show why it matters, but not at this point. Let's focus on tuple itself.
Is immutable?
Very good question. It's immutable. Of course, in JavaSlang, everything is immutable by default. You don't have immutable, mutable things. So if you change a tuple in such a way, it creates a new instance instead of modifying what's underneath it. And actually, let's have a look at it. So we already know how to create them. The of method will be common for all constructs, for functional interfaces, tuples, other functional control structures, whole collections API. Everything uses the same of method. So it's very predictable. When you want to create something, just use of method. So we created two tuples. Well, and let's now explore the whole API. Actually, if you go straight in here, you will see that, as you can see, of course, it's serializable. Of course, it implements already comparable. And you have quite a lot of methods over there. First thing that you really care about is accessing those values that are inside. Since this is an anonymous object, we don't have names for those parameters over there. So we can access them either by field or by method call. So it's your call, how you want to do this. But the biggest fun comes from additional methods as everywhere, because you have map 1, 2, swapping, and many other useful methods, okay? So let's use a map. Let's say that we want to perform a mapping of the first argument of the tuple. So we can the first one here is an integer. So let's say we double it. Okay. What we get there is a new tuple. Well, we get another tuple, and if we print it now, actually let's print both of them, of one. So let's print both of them. You will see that the first one remained unchanged. And the second one changed only the first object over there. So as you can see, you have full control over there because you have also like map, you have also map two, map everything, and so on and so on. Yes?
Why there is no map by index?
Actually, what do you mean by index? This is pretty much what you, if you by index refer to the index of those arguments inside, this is pretty much the convention that it followed here, that you have this index over there.
Maybe I just want like a have a map and map dynamically. I want maps as first variable, the second, the third.
Well, actually, I can't answer you why it wasn't introduced because, well, I didn't write it. But so yeah, the answer here is I have no idea. Yeah, why it wasn't introduced? Okay. Well, I would say that probably yes, because if you go by index, it becomes slicky a little bit, and here it's always you know what type are you referring to. Okay, so as you can see, any of them got changed. Of course, you can continue the whole chain of operations over there. You can additionally, let's say, swap the elements. So you can turn it upside down, the whole tuple. And you can see it's three is on the second position and not on the first. And of course, it's not zero indexed, it's one indexed. Okay, so let's go to another one.
One more question. What kind of structures behind tuple? How much memory it consumes?
Well, there is nothing special. There is no data structure behind it. If you go into this, you say you can hear that, see that this is just a simple reference over there. It's like a big, well, it's not a POJO, yeah, but those are just normal fields. And, well, as you can, of course, obviously no one did this manually. It's all auto-generated. And of course, goes up to this magic number of 8. Okay, let's go further. Of course, we can get arity and stuff. There was a very useful transform function, but it got deprecated in the newest 2.1.0 release, because actually what we are working right now is, well, is Java Slang, the newest version with the newest API. It's not production ready, it's an alpha version. It should be ready in a few months. So I don't really know why this got deprecated. Probably there will be some kind, it will be either moved somewhere else or renamed. But the idea behind transform is to take a function of that accepts all arguments in a tuple and return a result that it's not a tuple, that it's not wrapped in a tuple. But anyway, it's not there anymore, so let's just leave it, well, as it is. So when it comes to tuples, that would be all. It's very useful, serializable, and immutable. Let's go straight to functional control structures. So there are many of them. Doesn't make sense to overload you guys with all the information, so we'll focus on three most important ones that are being used on a everyday basics. Tuple. So first one we would like to talk about is option. Well, option works exactly like this one. All exactly like this one in Java, but the main the change that was introduced here is that option is serializable at some point. Well, okay, I won't be able to show this easily. Anyway, option is fully serializable, and it implements iterable too. Of course, it's immutable, of course. It implements iterable. It can be useful in some situations because actually, if you think about an option, it's like a container that contains zero or one value. So actually, it's pretty much equal to an iterable or collection that holds zero or one value, or a stream that's zero or one value, max one value. And it can be really easy. And let me show you how it looks like in Java. Let's say that you create arrays as list optional actually the easiest way would be to think functionally about this, do it like this, or even straight to stream of 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's map it and wrap it into optional of. Yes, we are on purpose using Java now. So now at this point, what we have stream of optionals. And what happens if you want to filter only values that are present? Okay? So actually let's use off nullable and let's put null here. So what we have here, again, let us, well, you shouldn't really do this, but let's do this only so that I can show you what types we are operating off on. So here is a stream of optionals. And let's say that we want to pick only those values that are inside. So what you do in Java? In Java, you have a stream, so you need to filter everything. And when you're filtering everything by optional is present, so now we narrowed the whole stream only to those three values, because this optional empty will be ignored. And now we need to create map optional get to extract those values from optional, and now collectors to list. Let's use this result, collect, sort, and run. So we should get only those three values. We managed to successively filter the whole stream of optionals and extract it. But let's have a look how many lines it took, okay? And this is pretty simple operation, so I believe there should be an easier way of doing this. But do you remember FlatMap? FlatMap is used in situations where you get nested structures. So let's have a look at example in Java Slang, but let's just in case Java 8. Okay, so let's recreate exactly the same example in Java Slang, but obviously we need to use something different, some different collections, because we are not operating on Java, ones from Java. So let's use stream, but from Java Slang, which is let's use a list, it will be easier. Wait a second, because we have list here over there. Set hash set. No. Okay. And so let's put there, let's say, three values. And at this point in Java Slang, you can notice that we already have an access to all those map, flat map. At this level, you don't need an additional special iterator for handling this. So here, we can go option of this one from Java Slang, and now we end up with pretty much with some iterable of options. Let's get rid of this. And we can, knowing that option can be treated as iterable, it helps us a lot, because if we perform a flat map operation, this is iterable, but option is an iterable too. So what happens now? Well, set. What happens over there is that we can perform flat map provided with an identity function, and that's all. We just managed to change this one, unpack all values from option at the same time by basically leveraging polymorphism. So result sort. OK, okay, we got a hash set of those three values. So again, what happened over there? We have a we have some collection or iterable of optionals, but both are iterables. So we ended up having a nested structure, iterable from iterable, okay? And flat maps are used for flattening those structures. So in such case, all empty optionals were treated as iterables, empty iterables, and those that were not were treated as iterables having one element. This is how we managed to do this in a simple one call instead of this. So as you can see, guys, the difference is quite a huge, and this is pretty useful. Yes?
I suppose you could miss null
and filter.
Wait a second. What do you mean? You don't need filter for this because the structure of an optional, okay? You don't need to manually filter it, which is empty is not. You just treat it as a collection. So the empty collection gets collapsed to zero elements, and a collection of one gets collapsed to element of one. So there's no need for filter. And if you go with this.
This hash set is for JavaSlang?
Yes, this is from a JavaSlang. I use this because we already imported lists and others, and I don't want to like use the full names for this. This is why I use this. But if
we convert it to optional to Java.
Yes, we will get to this. If you thinking about all those tools that we are talking right here, they have very nice interoperability with Java. But let's create another example for this. So option of something. And let's have a look further, okay? Besides those methods that you know from Java, you have some additional methods that come from the somewhere up in the type hierarchy, so some can be doubled actually, like this one. But if you go somewhere over there, you have two array, two char, two either, two Java array, Java list, and pretty much all those methods that you could ever possibly need. So if you really need to convert it to this or even parallel stream, it's not a problem. You get optional all over here, and you are back in Java world. So it's super super handy. Unfortunately, it's.
It's a weird name. We are writing Java code and say to Java.
Yes. Well, and do you have a better idea for name?
To original.
Well, in this case, actually, yes, it could be an easy way because you here you have option and here you have optional. Option is like the convention from Scala. But if you wanted to do other, like to array, well, suddenly it becomes hard, okay, to not because you have the same names. But yeah, native. But native is still fewer characters more. Anyway, it's fine because whenever you want native, you just go Java to Java something, and you have everything here.
But does it make a problem when you can, for example, you're using a set from JavaSlang, but your application here is expected from a set from an origin Java?
Well, it depends. If your application expects actually a set from a Java, yes, it's a problem. You need to obviously repackage it. But if you write your, if you plan your interfaces correctly, maybe if you don't really need this specific set behavior, you can still depend on the fact that somewhere in the type hierarchy there is a common denominator. There's a common ground. The iterable. Almost all tools from JavaSlang they implement iterable. So if you actually don't need specific set behavior, enforced uniqueness of elements, you can use iterables, and then you can pass all anything you want. But yeah, this is a very good point because we had one. I was working like 1 year ago in Y. very simple application of a very simple architecture, simple JPA, Hibernate, Angular stack. Well, the domain was very complicated, but we adopted Java Slang, but we almost never used Collections API. Why? Because when we were dealing with Hibernate and stuff, we would need to use repackaging all the stuff every time. First thing is that interfaces are not compatible. The second thing is that Hibernate doesn't work with immutable collections implementations. So this created a lot of problems. And we decided to not use Collections API in most things because the simple map filter operations were all we needed.
We didn't need more stuff from this, but I was creating an application that was essentially like a document scanner, an engine for document scanning. And this is where we totally switched to Java Slang collections, and it worked pretty well. Okay, let's go further. So we already noticed how option by Java Slang can be seen as iterables. So let's explore what else do we have here. Most of them actually, well, if we look from the statistical point of view, most of the time we will just map filter and get or else versions.
I guess this is fall behind in those normal distribution in those three sigmas from both ways. But yeah, if you really need some interoperability, you have pretty much everything that you might ever need here. The downside of the Java Slang API is that when you actually go there and try to traverse everything, values, iterables, actually I see that in 2.1.0 they simplified it, but they managed to abstract quite a lot of levels here, many layers. And some methods are duplicated. And sometimes you find two methods that do the same, and you find a comment, well, don't use this one, use the other one. Okay, and this API is contaminated a little bit when it comes to this. But yeah, but newest release should make clean up everything. And the biggest change should be, the API should be absolutely clean when release 3. Appears because it's everything, because obviously when you use semantic versioning you can break things up when you change major versions. So 3 will change backwards compatibility, will be released with Java 9, and we'll have a clean API. Well, with a little bit more thought put into this.
At least you have a home.
Yes, okay, so yes, as you can see, the API is pretty much similar to what that we found in Java. Let's go further. Let's explore a new monadic container, which is a try. So we already got to know streams, optionals, which are kind of containers where you wrap values. Well, try is pretty much, it follows the same principle, but this time we are encapsulating, we are dealing with situations where exceptions can be thrown. So optional was dealing with nullability, streams was dealing with helping us with dealing with iterations, and try is helping us dealing with exceptions. So let's see. Of course, if you want to try to create a new instance, you can say, for example, you can provide it with a result, something. Here, there might some exception pop up. So let's have a look at the API. As you can see, we have map and filter. And after this point, we don't really need to worry about exceptions anymore because the container deals with them for us. We can focus on declaratively providing it with stuff that needs to be done. So as always, we can just string to uppercase it, then filter as length bigger than 0, let's say. And then we can finally either get the result, which is basically not very useful, because if exception happened over there, it will just propagate it further. But you can, for example, get or else, okay? So let's try to actually use the result. Let's try to print it. So in this case, obviously, we'll end up with a converted result according to what we did over there. But let's copy all of this. And let's force an exception here to be thrown. Throw new legal state exception. Wait a second, because it doesn't know that.
Type off.
Mm-hmm. Let's try to type it. Yep. So in such case, if we run it, we will see that here should default appear. Okay, so we managed to deal with the exception in a nice and declarative way. So again, obviously, this is what we are after creating the container, and those are basically only like an expression of our will, what to do with those values that are inside.
If I want to get exception, I want to know what exception happens, I should lock this exception.
Don't worry about this. Well,
let's proceed some exception.
Okay, don't worry. Let's go further with another one. Obviously, so it was a very generic case when you just don't care about the exception. Well, so as you can see, we have many different overloaded methods here, and some of them actually provide the functions that deal with the exception itself. So let's have a look here. Let's look get or else get. And let's have a look, what do we get here? We get a function that gets an exception over there that was thrown. So in this case, or else get, let's say, get the get class to string. Okay, and if we run it, we manage to access the actual exception. Yeah, so yeah, it's useful, don't worry.
Is it possible to simultaneously get the exception and provide the default result?
What would you like to do? Log exception?
Yes, log exception, well, and return the default.
Yeah, it's not a problem, because in such case you just need to change this to...
Okay.
X get class. This class get to string sort and return default. So yeah, obviously it's doable. Yeah, so we managed to log the exception and return a default value. Let's go further.
Is there something like finally?
I don't remember. I don't think so. I don't think so. No, I would be surprised. I never saw this. Anyway, we have also very nice things like on failure, for example. Of course, you can provide it with out print line. What's really nice is that you can chain it, because in Java, like in optional, if you use if present or something, it returns void. It doesn't allow you to chain those operations. But here you can keep chaining it and further. So it's super useful if you want to prepare the whole chain. What's also interesting over here is that you have something like recover, And this you can see you can give the exception type and then function that should be done in such a case. So for example, if you provide it with egocet exception class, and now let's say you want to return recovered get or else default. Okay, so in such case we can declaratively deal with some examples on the fly, because maybe some exceptions we are expected and we can deal with them at this particular moment. So maybe let's do another one. Maybe let's see if it works.
What if two times recover the same exception?
Well, it's an interesting question. Well, I guess nothing. But let's see if it overrides the behavior. No, it doesn't. I guess as we can see, it just stores them as pairs internally. So, and there were some rules and it fall into the first one. Yeah, but yeah, it's pretty much.
And if you type like exception.
Oh, exception class, you mean? Mm-hmm. Something like this. That's interesting. Well, obviously, because it's like a pattern matching. It goes down. The first matched. It was the first match over there and doesn't go over there. So I guess if we even actually, if we change it and run it, it will still fall in the first one, I guess. Yeah, because the first matched.
No, it's just after this one, the first one, there's no more exception, so that is in this state of error anymore.
Oh, right,
so
yeah.
If you borrow another exception, the second one will.
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. If we look, well, what we can do right now is still we have another map call over there, yeah, and the same, it continues. So, really, you can continue a very, like, really complicated flows over there. Well, and I think that's all, because as you can see, there is a filter method which works exactly as expected, as is in the among the whole API. You have for each, which is pretty much very intuitive. But still, as you can see, for each is something that's rather associated with collections. And again, try, if you go traverse the whole type hierarchy, it extends value too, and it's iterable too. Because as we saw this example with a list of optionals and collapsing them using flatmap, you can do the same with try. Because try can be seen again as a collection of zero of one element. So when exception was thrown, when the try is empty, it's zero with an exception. When there's something is there, it's one, okay? So if you wanted to, for example, have like, maybe we won't be doing this, but let's show. We could have a list of try of string calls, list of try of. Okay, and if we wanted to collapse it, we would use again a flat map in such case and get. It's a list of.
No, we should have a list of strings.
Type of float. Change.
What?
List of string.
List of string, not a
list. Okay. Yeah, we are. Yes, this is the problem. So let's just save it here. Calls flat map. This and again, everything is flattened, okay? So this could be, for example, like a list of some HTTP calls. Let's say that we are calling in accessing, let's say, 10 or generally n some online resources, doing HTTP gets. Let's say that 5 of them doesn't work, and we care only for those that worked, and this is how we extract only those that worked. Probably in such case you would rather use something async, but well, I think it's a good example anyway. So that would be this when it comes to try. Again, the whole API is very similar to optional, option, and other stuff. Let's go further. We'll be lazy. So, lazy allows us to deal with initialized and non-initialized values in like in very in a lazy way. Lazy, of course, is another monadic container. Of course, it follows the whole this the convention. So you have off method like this, and let's say let's create something again. Thread sleep return 42. Okay, let's line it. Lazy. So we end up with something like this. Obviously, we defined a value calculated lazily. When we run it, we don't get basically anything here, obviously, because it's lazy. And what's very nice right now is that, of course, the API is similar to try and others like this. So we can express our will by doing, well, again, string to uppercase, maybe map another, maybe filter as length lower than quite a lot, so that make sure that it goes through, and so on and so on. Everything getter else, and those methods come basically all from some higher type, so this will be similar, it will be shared among all those types. And this is everything the same as you would expect it to be. So, but let's call it again. What will happen? Nothing. Nothing, exactly. Because still, at this point, well, why? Okay, because it needed to be calculated over there. Okay, but still, if we use another, maybe more complex type, we would be able to use, it would be evaluated straight at get call. And, well, not in a start situation, okay, because it's a trivial example. So pretty much the idea is to have... let me get rid of it. Well, this is a bad example because this needs to get white.
Maybe because of filter, because it means.
Well, this is actually surprising because I'm not sure why, but it shouldn't behave like this.
Could you please try without filter?
It shouldn't change the fact. But why filter at this point? Wait a second. Let's have a look inside. Oh yeah, yeah. So actually, I learned some. We all learned something very, very important. Is that suddenly this? Well, this is. I would say this is a bug. I would say this is a bug. Okay. Yeah, that filter isn't lazy. This is a bug. Yeah. So let me save it somewhere, because we can go to GitHub and just ask why it's not.
Open Jira.
Right now?
Yeah.
Okay, if you're, well. GitHub Java, huh? Okay, let's do this. New issue. Wait, what can you repeat, please?
Maybe it's already there, so we're about to check right now.
If it already exists, right? Lazy.
That's duplicated.
Filter lazy. Well, I don't think we can, let's say, in reasonable time, just... Oh, yes. Yeah, okay. Well, yeah, so... Oh, it's merged. Okay, so as you can see, Oh, because this, as you can see, well, it's been 1 year. It's patched. Well, but let's see which version does it target. Well, oh my. So we found a bug. I'm not sure in which version this is. This is resolved, but I will check it, and if it's not, we'll raise another issue. Yeah, but it's a very good idea to remember about this. I will just bookmark it. Okay, let's go further. So yeah, in a perfect world, that would be pretty lazy. And so we could just keep going on and on, and eventually everything would get evaluated at a get call. Obviously, this can be again treated as iterable. So if we are, let's say, if we have a collection of lazies and we are just and we want to pick them that were evaluated or not, we can use a simple FATMAP call for this. So basically that would be this when it comes to this one, because this is the whole API is the same as with try. So at this point, let's have a look at collections. So actually, let's help ourselves with Java Slang IO. We need to have a look at the whole collections thing is pretty complex. Well, let's just open it. As you can see, this is pretty much the whole, well, not really whole type hierarchy when it comes to collections. Well, I can already see that it's outdated because something like a new bit set was introduced recently. So probably you can't see it well enough, so let me read it.
Why didn't they combine iterable and traversable interface?
Well, you can't combine iterable because it already exists in Java. So you can't pretty much...
I mean just not create traversable.
Not create. I don't know. As I remember, there is a lot of Scala inspiration in this, so they wanted to mirror the... Well, it's a direct copy of the from Scala, okay? The idea was to bring all the Scala goodies straight to Java. So don't know for sure, but probably it's just the idea to like mirroring the type hierarchy in Scala. So what you can see here is some all classes that you probably all know well. Array, track sequence, vector, stack, list, stream, queue. But let's have a look at stream for a moment. Let's hold the here for a while, because as stream is not the same as in Java. In Java it's an iterator. His is a normal class. It's totally reusable and still lazily initialized. Also you have like hash set, tree set, linked hash map, tree map, tree, and simple iterator. What's super nice about it is that their API is super rich. Let's have a look over there. Obviously, so if you want to create a list, you use this generic of method that applies for everyone. List, and let's browse the API. So what do we have here? We have all those common methods available already at the list level, so there's no need for like a stream middleman as in Java. But we all know how it works, so we'll not get into simple filter map examples. But here, fun happens. Because you can easily append new element to the whole collection. In stream, in Java 8, it was impossible. It was very painful to do this. If you really wanted to add even a single element to a stream, you needed to use a helper method, stream combine, create stream from one element and combine two streams together. It's a shame, okay? It's a pile of shame, let's name it like this.
So of course, you can append other things, other lists, other iterables, okay? Those can be stuff, of course, from the Java 8, so why not add more? What happens over there is we have combinations, which is super, super nice, because for example, you can generate all possible combinations of this list, okay? So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Let's try to print all of them out. Well, and as you can see, it generated, well, actually it would be easier to see if we had, if we didn't have those two over here. You see, it generated all possible combinations of those elements. So we have a lot of very, very small, very, very useful methods. Of course, as you can see another time, group by is available at this level. No need for special collectors, grouping by, and other, well, unnecessary stuff. You can quickly extract last element as an optional, as a nullable value. There are different options for creating combinations. You can pick a number for them. There can be a cross product with different powers. Distinct, available at this level. And very important thing, distinct by, which I felt it was very missing from Java 8 Stream API, because there is also available method like distinct, which allows you to declaratively just iterate over only unique values in a stream, but you need to use underlying hash code or equals implementation for comparing the files together. But what if you wanted to provide it with your custom comparator? There's no way of doing this in Java 8, and yet here it is in a few different options. Well, you can drop your elements from the front. You can drop right, drop until, drop while. This is super useful because, for example, in Java 8, if you wanted to create like a sequence, for example, of dates, using some additional method, let's say create all dates from 1 month to the other. Okay, you could not just create an infinite sequence and say just cut off the sequence after some date. There was no option. There was no drop until, drop while, or take while, take until. What in such case you needed to do was calculate manually the amount of days between the end, and use a limit function to limit the length of the whole stream, which was super painful. Actually, with Java time, it became quite easy because you have easy way of calculating the number of days between two dates. So it was fine. Well, but still pretty bad. And this will be fixed. This will be fixed in Java 9 in both ways, because you'll be getting in local date API for creating stream of dates, and there will be a take while, drop while introduced to the stream API. Well, a few years too late. Okay, so of course, well, you can check if something is infinite or not. In Java, it's not possible. There were some explanation. Some methods were not introduced to Java Stream API because, well, on DevOps, Stuart Mark said that they couldn't. there is no way of checking if it's infinite or not. Well, JavaSlang guys did it. So collections. If if you use streams from JavaSlang, of course you can check if it's infinite or not. Well, obviously you can add new elements, partition them, extract elements one or with options and so on, remove, shuffle, what's very, very useful, sort it according to a comparator, which is not possible, I think, or it is, I don't remember, but I think it's not possible to sort a stream according to custom comparator. Is possible? Okay, I didn't remember about this.
And sliding it means that it will return some window.
Which one?
Sliding. Slice and sliding.
Slice is slicing, as you can see, with between. You pick a slice out of the whole list, and sliding, I have no idea what this means. Let's see. Well, okay. Slide the window. Oh, and step size one over. What?
So you can
window.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but using iterate using a custom specified window. Okay. So what's also very useful is like when you have to, you can convert it to everything, as you can see again, to Java collections and stuff. Some doesn't really make sense because I don't think you would often convert a whole list to optional in such case. But anyway, it's super rich. And of course, maybe I didn't show this yet, but let's, if we drop something, let's say one element, and if we now print a first list and new list, as you can see, the result, the first list got unchanged, okay? And this is super nice. Actually, the whole collections API in Java 8 was pretty limiting, because if you look actually in the array list, list collections, you have all those methods like add, but what's happening over there? As you can see, it returns a boolean value instead of another, instead of a copy with a new, letting the original collection being unchanged. And this collections API interfaces are so important, and we have them everywhere. So it makes some, well, like immutability really painful, because suddenly, when you even when you pass like an immutable implementation, you still need to do something with those methods. In Guava, for example, just throws exceptions that operations are not supported, and this is super, super weird, super bad, and not easy to use. Okay, if you want to create a copy, let's say with one new element, it's super painful because you need to manually instantiate everything and add all new values to collection. What's also super important is, in Java slang utilizes something, the concept called as persistent collections. Persistent collections is a very efficient way of creating immutable structures, because the problem with immutability in general is that, well, at some point you get run out of memory when you just start copying everything. If you need to add, let's say, 100 separate elements to your collection, you would need to create 100 separate copies, and when most of them would be left unused. So in order to deal something with this, the concept of persistent collections was created. It could be also understood as recursive types. So in this case, in order to achieve immutability, we are not creating the whole copies, but creating the implementation of structures in a recursive way. So when we look at the if we look at the list from Java slang, well, it has quite a lot of interesting extensions over there. But if you find the cons, let's find where the values get stored. Well, it will be hard. Well, we can see that we have this cons implementation over there, and this is, as you can see, this is how list is organized internally. So we have a recursive type that has inside a head element, one single element, and the list of another list called the tail. And whenever we are modifying a list by adding or removing elements, we are creating a new instance of this, but the previous list becomes a tail. So when you are adding a new element, the previous list gets reused, okay, instead of just being unwanted byproduct. So in such case, everything gets reused, and we can save a lot of memory on this. Also, it gives us a possibility of, like, as you can see, calculating statically length and storing this and caching this. Actually, if you really want to get to know more about this topic, there's one talk by Oleg Shelaev from Zero Turnaround. He made this talk on DevOps and on JavaOne about functional data structures, and he talks for like more than 1 hour about how different persistent collections are constructed. Because this is just one side of the coin. This is only a very simple example about adding stuff to a list. But if you want to implement a map, a queue, or a set, it becomes suddenly much harder to organize it in some kind of recursive way. Most of the time, you will just, for example, queues, you would try to somehow implement it using already persistent lists. But yeah, there is quite a big topic because there are many different implementations exist. Some favor additions, some favor removals, some favor appendings, of course. So yeah, that's a very good, very, very huge topic. You definitely should check Oleg Shelaev's talk about this subject. We'll not get further into this. I just want to note that those types that we're talking about, the whole type hierarchy in JavaSlang, those are all persistent. So they all utilize this concept over there. And let's move now.
JavaSlang has zip function.
Oh yeah, it's a very, very good idea that you brought this one. Well, for example, what was very missing from Java 8 Stream API was something like a zip function. Zipping is allow if you, well, let's create another list. Let's make it string. 1, 2, 3. And zipping allows you to just connect two lists, to zip them together with themselves. So what will happen when we call zip on another list? And we would get a list of tuples. Okay? We already know what tuples is. We are creating pairs of those corresponding elements together. So what happens over there? Wait a second. What happens over there is zip function takes the first element of this and tuples it with this one. This with this one and this with this one. And we can see it in that it actually works. You can see we created a new list with combined zipped elements from those two lists together.
What if you increase first list by one?
It's a good question. What happens over there? Actually, wait, I will create another one. Yep. As you can see, it got zipped with nothing. So no result.
Is it possible to zip three or more lists?
Because
we have tuple 2, tuple 3, tuple 4, tuple 5.
Zip three lists with together. It's a good question. I have no idea, honestly. Let's see, what do we have here? Zip. You can unzip, surely.
Unzip
all. Now it looks like. No, but it's.
Okay.
Yeah, so. Anyway, I don't think that's usable use case to zip more than three, but it's Yeah, it's interesting that.
Is JavaSlang also lists, tuples supported by MySQL, MongoDB, and others?
Not directly, but more and more libraries are using JavaSlang. For example, I think new Spring Data is compatible with JavaSlang. Mm-hmm. I think when. I don't remember, it was like some recent release, very recent, like from a few 2 weeks ago. QueryDSL, I think, has Java Slang support. Anyway, the adoption is really going on. More and more projects start to support this. So, yeah, usually when dealing with such stuff like converting from databases, I would expect most of them to not work directly. But more and more libraries are actually noticing Java Slang and trying to create some kind of adapters that would work with it. So, for example, I know that Spring Web, in Spring Data, surely you can return option Java Slang option as when fetching data from the repository. Some time ago, it was a big breakthrough because they managed actually to use optionals with this, but now Java Slang is also accepted. Well, so I guess there will be more and more integrations with existing libraries coming on soon. So, yeah. I hope so, because as I told you before, with Hibernate we were forced to use, because the necessity of sticking to Java collections with Hibernate made us abandon using most of the Java Slang constructs. Okay, let's go straight to the last pass, to pattern matching. Well, so again, what pattern matching is? Pattern matching is a switch case on steroids. It allows you to, it allows you to define different cases in which the matched element can fall through and associate some actions with it. So, unfortunately, Java Slang can only operate on Java, okay? It's limited by Java, so it's not a new language construct. Although it might look very weird because we are using like uppercase weird classes over there, we are using signs like dollars and underscores, but those are all basically just static methods. So yeah, it's doing as much as possible to give pattern matching to Java users. So let's have a look how it looks like. Let's create some value. Let's say 42. And now it gets pretty tricky because actually the hardest part for me with pattern matching from Java Slang is that it's dealing with imports and type inference, because very often you need to just provide some additional hints so that it compiles properly. So this is how it looks. If you want to access the pattern matching API in Java Slang, you go for match class, and here you can specify your value. By the way, we are operating on new experimental API from 2.1.0 version, so this might change. So we have this one. It's all available in the AP package. We will import it later statically, but now I don't want to, my idea just optimize imports and get rid of it. So we are performing matching of this value. And now we can create off as always, and inside we can specify different cases that this value can fall into. Okay, and specify some special things over there. So, for example, less than 2, and let's provide it with a predicate. We need to use a helper dollar in this. Unfortunately, because this is the only way it could have been possible done, e is less than 2. Of course, it won't compile until I put the last mark over there. Let's use another case. Dollar I bigger than 5. Bigger than 5. Okay, now we need to try to make it work somehow, because there is this case goes here. I guess there is too many of them. Yes, done. And now we can access the result. Well, thanks, idea, for formatting my code. So yeah, this is how it looks like. Result. And as you can see, this is what happened here. So what we managed to accomplish over there, as you can see, this can be not very easy to accomplish in many cases because there is a lot of stuff to be written. And those are still basically, this is a static method, okay? This is another static method. Those are static methods. So it's, if you don't know the app well, there will be a lot of trouble with it because as you can see, it will compile only when you put last bracket over there. But as you can see, it worked. We created a set of conditions. So we had a set of cases that this value can fall into. So the first, the easiest one is the first one is the if that this value is less than 2, another one is bigger than 5. So I can see, as you can see, this was compared against this one and it wasn't matched, okay? Because this is bigger than 2. So this fell into this category, and as you can see, this was matched, and this is why we got this. Okay, it's a very, very good question. Well, the answer is that it has the priority. It's prioritized by order. So if it falls in this category, it will not bother with evaluating this one. You can see it right there. Yes. Yes. It won't be evaluated further. Okay. It stops on the first one. But the question, what happens if we don't get a match? Let's say in this case nothing should get matched. So obviously in such case we probably expect some exception to be thrown. Yeah, we got Java slang match error. And if you really want to deal with such cases, you need to there is a separate method for this. And probably here, instead of off, you can use option. And as you might expect it to be, it doesn't return a string, but returns an optional with a string inside, okay? So
in Scala we can use default.
Mm-hmm. Of course, obviously there is no default because it will be very, very hard to implement it so that it blends in with the whole, well, let's say APIs that consist mostly of workarounds here. So let's go further. What's super nice is that Java slang comes with a set of predefined predicates, okay? So as you can see here, in many cases you can use help from them. Let's create a new match. So predicates instance of, and it will be, let's say, thread class. Why not? Then it's a thread. Of course, we can just quickly import it. Let's create another one. Okay, and here if it's an integer, so we are not only limited to like using basic simple conditions, but so and we can use.
Maybe result.
Wait a second, probably it's just... I don't really see the problem over here. Well, as you can see, this is the problem that I'm not really using pattern matching quite often, because in Scala, well, in Scala it's problematic too. It sometimes can cause problems like this. And now, well, though all this stuff, it's very hard to like debug with your own eyes to see where they're missing brackets or something, or where types are not matching. This is super annoying actually, and probably because let's just import everything. No, dollar should still be here because instance of predicates.
Maybe dollar just wraps lambda into predicate, and predicates has it by itself.
No, wait, we will get, because this dollar is even more interesting, because you don't need to perform pattern matching using predicates. You can put actual value inside. Let's go back to the working example, and yeah, it's just, it will be easier to do it like this. Let's just exchange those parts over there. Predicates, instance of something, integer class, and now it compiles, you see. So let's take this one, put it here. Yeah, everything is fine. So, thread class, integer class, of course, doesn't matter now. You have predicates, and it's not compiling. Yeah, this is the problem I've been talking about. This is super annoying. But as you can see, it's all up to, because of the problem with type inference, because at some point, in this case, we know that this is integer, which is getting we're getting as a result, but when you have few instances of predicates, you don't know which one is it. So probably the answer is that if we try doing this once again, you just need to perform a cast somewhere there. So try again. Yes, because this doesn't understand what's happening over there, because we can't assume what kind of instance we are operating on. Wait a second. What do you mean?
The first line method. Higher.
Replace the type of value
to object.
We mean like here?
Value 42.
Line.
Replace
line 42.
This with object. Yeah, you see, this is really, really painful, because there is no support of on language level on this. So, but yeah, probably. Well, sorry. Can you just raise your hand? Okay. Yeah. So as you can see, well, this is all what we can do, because this is still, those are just improvised pattern matching solutions. It works nice for very simple cases, but if you want to get deeper, it becomes really painful, because you need to keep hinting it with some answers, okay? Hinting it what types we are expecting, or what we are matching. Actually, it made a lot of sense, okay? Because if we knew that it's integer, it doesn't make sense to provide it to the pattern matching. Okay? What's also really interesting is that if you are dealing, let's get back to this one. Is that instead of putting this, you can, for example, put the value inside, okay? So let's say 42, okay? So we have three different cases now, and we can check if this fits one particular value or if it's less or bigger than this. So in order to see this, let's start with 42. Well, it's well, that's okay, so as you can see, it got matched. But if we used another value over there, obviously it skips and goes further. Well, let's make it more dramatic. Okay, because obviously it didn't get matched anyway now. Okay, and as you can see, everything works now. There is also, in the previous API, there was an exploration of structural pattern matching, but it's not there anymore, at least it's in very experimental stage. The structural pattern matching works in such a way that you can provide as object, for example, the object definition, and put dollars like inside it. So for example, if we had our own class, let's say class person, string name, string surname. Structural pattern matching works in such a way that you could provide a case with person, and here provide, for example, a name here, Adam, and here, for example, nothing. But it's changing. For example, now it was available in versions pre to 2.1.0. Now it's being constantly developed, and it's not really 100% sure if it will be included in the final version. This is why I won't be showing this right now. Surely it caused a lot of problems, because in Scala and functional languages, the whole point of structural pattern matching is that it can be recursive, but you can't do this recursively in Java. Because why it's done internally? Internally, it was done in such a way that obviously we have some Scala generator which generates all possible static methods so that they match all possible different signatures over there. Well, Daniel Dietrich, the creator of JavaSlang, when he went for a recursive solution, well, it's implementable. He implemented it. But the problem was when dealing with slightly bigger classes, well, not really bigger, even like four or three fields, the generator would generate so many methods that you would go over all like physical limits of the JVM. So yeah, this is, yeah, because obviously you need to create like technically infinite amount of recursive nested versions for it. Obviously you need to stop at some point, but even going few levels deep was not possible to handle by the JVM, even with such like amounts of method in one class.
Can we compare stream utils with JavaSlang streams?
Well, I remember I used stream utils some time ago. If you don't know, this is an additional library with enhancements for streams. But obviously, this is different scope of the project. JavaSlang brings too much many things, and stream utils are just like small patches for what's in stream API. If you want to explore actually something project that's comparable to this, check JOO Lambda. It's made by Lucas Eder that made JOOQ, and it also implemented some things in a different way than JavaSlang. This is a project worth going through. Let me show you JOO Lambda. it's this one, so definitely you should have a look at this one. It's very good. If you really want to know the performance behind JavaSlang, there is an additional module. Well, actually, if you go to straight to JavaSlang.io, well, GitHub JavaSlang. You can see that there is like a line where they are running benchmarks. There is also somewhere here there is a special topic when they are comparing benchmarks against Scala, Scala Z, Java 8, collections, and I think something more. Usually JavaSlang is performing slower, depends on the context, but obviously if you're playing 2 or 3 times slower than collections API. But you need to remember that when working with immutable and persistent collections, you are getting thread safety for free. So you are comparing like mutable, not thread safe collections API with a fully persistent and immutable thread safe collections API. So obviously there's some trade-off. You get thread safety, but it needs to be slightly slower because you can't modify your result, but you need to create new instances. I don't remember where it is, but if you Google JavaSlang, JavaSlang benchmark, maybe in this module, there is somewhere at least a comparison. Actually, it performs really well against Scala, but it's not like all of them are faster. Some are faster, some are slower. Okay, so there's no like. No clear winner, okay? Because it all depends on the context and on choosing right tool for the right job. So, are there any further questions?